Hello all. So we are here in a doctor's talk video, and today we have with us Dr. Sunaina Bansal. Dr. Sunaina Bansal, welcome. And I'm going to introduce
How are you?
Good, ma'am, good. So we are going to introduce Dr. Sunaina Bansal. So Dr. Sunaina Bansal is a senior consultant gynecologist at Cloud 9 Hospitals in Chandigarh. She did her MD DNB from BJ Medical College Ahmedabad and her MBBS from Pandit BDS PG IMS Rohtak. And you know, I was so moved by, you know, she, when the COVID this thing started, the second wave started, you know, she put out that anybody who's a COVID patient and in a gynecological emergency, she's put her, you know, like a small little service for everybody. She's put, you know, like a poster around that anybody who wants help, they can directly contact ma'am. That was a great move, ma'am. And you know, we are like very interested today to know, you know, a lot of questions related to COVID and gynecology. So, you know, like you are an expert, very senior gynecologist who have, you know, seen a lot of patients for so many years now. So ma'am, like I'll start with a few questions. The first question that we have is, you know, as COVID has been there for a year and a half and there are no signs of it ending, can couples, you know, planning a baby consider going ahead?
Yes, couples planning a pregnancy must go ahead. In fact, as you said, there's no signs of COVID, you know, disappearing. So it's going to stay with us. So definitely one can plan a pregnancy, go ahead. And in fact, if possible, take a vaccination before planning a pregnancy and very safely go ahead with their plans of conception. There is no contraindication to that.
Okay, so ma'am, thank you. We'll come to vaccination soon. But, you know, before that, I just want to ask you, you know, like a very simple question. Maybe it's a taken for granted for you. Is the mother and child at an increased risk during the current COVID crisis? For IVRs, if you can tell them.
Okay, so pregnant women are at a little increased risk to contract not only COVID, but in general, any kind of infection and any kind of viral infection because their immunity is a little compromised during pregnancy. So they must keep all the precautions. And in particular to, they are not at an increased risk to contact the COVID infection. And, but yes, they are more likely to require hospital admissions or ICU admissions in case they develop severe symptoms. In most of the pregnant women, the disease would remain asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. But yes, if they develop severe symptoms, it can lead to complications. There's a high risk of that. Babies as such are not at an increased risk to develop COVID infection. Okay. It is only from their mothers that they would acquire it.
Okay, so babies, you know, are not at an increased risk directly. It's only through their mothers that they can, you know, contract this disease. So ma'am, the next question is like, if a lady gets pregnant, if a lady is pregnant and she gets symptoms of COVID, what steps should she take? And is a child at a definite risk in that case? No, a related question.
Okay, so there are two questions. One is what a pregnant lady should do if she gets a COVID infection. Second question we'll take later, if the child is at a definite risk of getting the infection. So first of all, if a pregnant lady gets COVID infection, she should not panic at all. In most probability, she will have little or no symptoms. So she should isolate herself, speak to her team of doctors, which should include her obstetrician as well as her physician. She should take a good diet.
Hello? Can you hear me, ma'am? No, ma'am.
So she has to deal with a COVID infection with a lot of positive attitude, a good diet, exercise, her supplements, regular supplements, a lot of steam, gargles, as we all know. And hopefully she will recover from it within a couple of days, 10 days to 2 weeks time. But she should be cautious. If she develops any symptom of a severe infection, like any kind of chest pain or breathlessness or a high grade fever that is not remitting or a very prolonged or a severe kind of cough, she should immediately report to her caregivers. She should not stay at home. That is important because in pregnancy, especially in the third trimester, things can really go, you know, out of the way, and she might need urgent hospitalization or urgent care. So she should be cautious. And most of the times it would be mild symptoms only.
So the third trimester is the 7th, 8th and the 9th month.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Just for
the
our
last
audience.
3 months. Okay. Yes. So the second question that you took was whether the baby is at a definite risk. See, there are not many reports of any kind of vertical transmission to the baby. So the baby is not at all at an increased risk of getting the COVID infection through the mother. So though there is a probable risk, but no such reports. And the newborn baby is, yes, the baby is definitely at a risk from contacting the infection from a severely symptomatic or a, you know, hugely symptomatic mother. So we'll come to that later on. A newborn does carry a little risk, but again, these babies are usually asymptomatic and they do not require any major, they do not usually develop any kind of severe infections.
Okay. And ma'am, as you spoke about, requirement of a caregiver, requirement of, reaching out to a healthcare professional. So, currently going to hospitals or the clinic for checkups, medications, and the non-COVID vaccinations, which are normally given to pregnant ladies, is part of this whole pregnancy process. So is it safe right now for a pregnant lady to visit a healthcare setting owing to the risk of COVID infection? Or, can she discontinue her visits, or is there any alternate to these visits? What do you say about this, ma'am?
Now here comes the role of both her caregivers, both the doctors whom she is going to. And here, we have to see a few visits are mandatory during her entire pregnancy checkups. So, but nowadays the doctors all over the country and all over the world, plus here also, we all are trying to minimize the physical visits of the patients as much as possible. We are trying to give teleconsultations to the obstetric patients whenever it is possible. There would be few visits when the lady would be required to come to the hospital for a checkup because a physical examination is important, or because an ultrasound is important, or her vaccination is needed. So during those visits, she would be required to be in the hospital. And we are trying to cut down on these hospital visits as much as possible. And during those visits, when she is coming to the hospital, she has to take a lot of caution in terms of, preventing herself from the COVID infection. And we routinely are issuing advisories to all the ladies who are coming for the antenatal checkups, the kind of precautions that they need to take. That is very important. And that's all. They just need to take care of themselves to prevent a COVID infection.
Okay. So you spoke about a lot of preventions while going to the visits, which you have greatly reduced, also you spoke about, you're trying to reach out to these ladies through teleconsultation. So that my next question is regarding that. So is it possible for a doctor to examine or treat a gynae patient over teleconsultation? Won't it lead to an inaccurate diagnosis or lack of a complete picture? You know better, ma'am. So could you like enlighten us on this, please?
When we advise, when we ask a patient to come for a teleconsultation, there could be pregnant women, or there could be in general other women who might require care for some other problems. So first of all, they interact with the clinician, and we try to understand whether her condition would require a physical examination or not. Many of the times, it is possible that the lady might not require a physical examination, and she can be treated over phone with the help of, after listening to her symptoms, she can be treated with the help of a teleconsultation, and the medications can be prescribed to her. Many times, a physical examination is needed for her to make a diagnosis. But again, in such a scenario, in terms of the calamity that we all are facing, we have to weigh the risks versus benefits of a hospital visit. If it seems very important that she should visit a hospital, otherwise our diagnosis or her treatment would be, greatly suffer, or we might mistreat her, then we would definitely call her for a physical examination. And if we can make an empirical diagnosis and treat her on a presumption, so especially for people who have to come from far-flung areas or who have to travel through public transports, where we don't require, where we don't want them to, you know, go through that all that stuff. So we would definitely like to treat them in a presumptive way. It is possible that the diagnosis could be inaccurate, but then we make sure that we, you know, the treatment given is not in such a way that would create any harm to the patient. So we have to benefit the risks and benefits of doing a teleconsultation with the patient. And otherwise, if it is needed, we definitely call the patient for a physical examination. And for obstetric patients, for pregnant women, we always limit the number of visits to specific timings. These timings are usually at 8 weeks and then 12 weeks, then 20 weeks, a 28-week visit, and then a 36-week visit. And these patients, all the women are specifically told to keep a kick count to understand the movements of the baby, to get their blood pressure measured at home, and to look for any kind of untoward signs and symptoms. In case they feel any of those signs and symptoms, they should immediately report to us. So it's the, you know, they are explained everything, and then we are constantly in touch with all of them so that any kind of problem, they can immediately report to the hospital also, or we treat them over phone only.
That's a great detailed answer, ma'am. A great lot of help for a lot of viewers who are listening to us. Now, ma'am, a few questions regarding vaccination, ma'am. So as pregnant ladies were not, you know, or not are not allowed, so ma'am, you'll tell us about the latest regulations regarding this, to get vaccinated for a long time now. Are there any other measures they can take to ensure the safety of their unborn baby and of themselves? Hello?
Okay. Yeah, I got you. So you said that pregnant women are not being vaccinated. So what are the measures they should take to prevent themselves and their newborn unborn babies? Okay. So here again, I would stress upon one fact that they should prevent themselves from getting the infection first of all. Okay. Minimizing the number of hospital visits. See, there are many women, even now, women think, many people in general think that going to the hospitals is they have got an opportunity to go out of their homes. You know, while going to the hospitals. So they, doctor, we don't have any COVID symptoms. So you can see us. We, okay, and we are safe. We won't do you any harm. So we tell them that, okay, you are safe. You won't give me an infection, but maybe I can give you the infection. So coming to the hospital is a, you know, it's a hospital is a potentially, a potential place where you can get the COVID infection.
Yeah.
So why to visit unnecessarily? So people need to understand.
Yeah.
So first of all, minimizing the number of visits to your doctor. Secondly, taking all the precautions, as much as possible when you are coming to a hospital for a checkup. Because absolutely, there are all kinds of patients. We as healthcare providers regularly meet a lot of patients. So we are at a high risk of being a carrier ourselves.
Okay.
So when they are coming to the hospital, a few tips that they must observe, like wearing full-sleeved clothes, carrying a well-fitted, a proper medical-grade mask. They can wear a, you know, face shield over that mask. Then try payments online so you don't have to spend more time in the hospitals. Try to minimize the number of attendants that you are bringing to the hospital. If you are waiting for your turn and the doctor is busy, try to wait outside the hospital. Don't stay in the lobby of the hospital where there are a lot of patients or there is a crowd. Wait outside in your car and just give your phone number at the reception, that as soon as the doctor is available, they'll give you a call and then you can come into the hospital. Carry a sanitizer along with you. So whenever you touch any door handles or you receive any papers or you receive any payment from anyone, immediately sanitize your hands. again, physical examination would be limited, always, you know, sit at a distance from the doctor there. Nowadays, usually a glass screen or a plastic sheet between you and the doctor. So that minimizes the risk a lot. So whenever you are, when the doctor is physically examining you, so you should be wearing a mask and you should not be speaking at that time. If you know that the doctor is going to examine you physically, or if you have to go an ultrasound, you can carry your own disposable bed sheet or a bed sheet that you can wash later on. So these are certain things by which you can minimize the chances of your infection. And always go back to your home and take a bath, sanitize yourself properly, sanitize your clothes. These things are important. Okay. So the only way to prevent themselves is to prevent getting an infection. So that's very, very important.
Thank you for the great answer, ma'am. So post-delivery, ma'am, next question. Post-delivery, can women who are lactating and who are nursing their babies consider taking the COVID vaccine?
Okay, so here, there's a lot of controversy nowadays about the vaccines to be given to pregnant or breastfeeding women. Till a week back, we got an advisory from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare that pregnant and breastfeeding women cannot be given the vaccine because there are no safety trials of these vaccines. Before that, it was very random. People were being offered the vaccination. Because in general, these are not live vaccines. Okay, so any such kind of vaccines which are available earlier do not pose any threat to the pregnant lady or her unborn fetus. So these vaccines are generally safe, just that the vaccine trials have not been conducted. And in general, the safety of these vaccines, the benefits, they outweigh any kind of potential or theoretical risks that can arise because of the administration of these vaccines. So yesterday only, the National Technical Advisory for Immunization has made the recommendations to the government that all pregnant women be offered the vaccination, and they should decide after knowing the benefits and risks of taking the vaccine, and all breastfeeding women be given the vaccination. It is absolutely, when you are vaccinating a pregnant woman, you are immunizing her unborn baby also. Till now, we have no safety measures. We have no vaccinations for the children. But if a lady who is breastfeeding, again, she is transferring those vaccine-induced antibodies to her baby through the milk. So in general, the baby is also getting immunized. So this is a great way to immunization. So pregnant women and breastfeeding women, the advisory gave their recommendations yesterday, and we hope the government comes up with some positive guidelines. And because it's when a woman gets pregnant, it's a 9 months of pregnancy and then 2 years of breastfeeding. So these 3 years, we cannot, amidst this surge of, the COVID infection, it is our duty to safeguard the women and the children also.
Absolutely.
So COVID vaccination is an excellent way of, immunizing the mothers and the babies also indirectly.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, ma'am, you spoke about, while a woman is breastfeeding, they can transfer the COVID antibodies to the child and, protect the child. At the same time, one of the viewers asked this question. So, whether if a woman is breastfeeding and she suddenly starts feeling some symptoms. So is there a possibility that just like the antibodies came to the baby, can the infection also come to the baby? If that lady is breastfeeding and, she suddenly starts to get symptoms, should she immediately...
If a lady is breastfeeding and she gets a COVID infection, she can continue to breastfeed the baby depending upon her symptoms and her wellness, because any benefits of breastfeeding outweigh any kind of risks to the baby by a mildly symptomatic COVID positive mother. If the mother is unwell or she is severely symptomatic, then one may consider separating or isolating the baby. Here again, the mother can very safely express her breast milk, and some healthy caregiver who is not COVID positive, they can feed the baby through that expressed breast milk. COVID infection will not be secreted in the breast milk. It has not been found to be secreted in the breast milk. So breast milk is absolutely safe from a COVID positive mother. It is only that the now if the mother is mildly symptomatic, if she has a cold or a cough or a fever, and she chooses to breastfeed her baby, she should take all the precautions to prevent the transmission of infections to the baby, which will be in terms of washing her hands before picking up the baby for breastfeeding, wearing a good medical mask if she is symptomatic, a good grade medical mask before handling the baby or breastfeeding the baby, and yes, taking a good care, hand hygiene, that is important. And these are certain measures by which she can prevent the transmission to the baby. And then certain other things like maybe, you know, keeping a 6 feet distance when the baby is lying with the mother, or putting a curtain sheet between the bed of the mother and the baby. These are certain things which can be employed, which will help in the reducing the risk of transmission to the young baby. So these measures can be employed. She can safely continue to breastfeed.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. That is going to, you know, put a lot of light to this, you know, issue which has not resolved for a lot of people. And, you know, people can, you know, understand that this breastfeeding largely outweighs, as you have said, any other risk, you know, of the infection, because, you know, at the end of the day, the child has to be given mother's milk. So, ma'am, the next question that has to be asked is, you know, a lot of people in Delhi, a lot of, you know, young people started to get vaccinated. So, you know, a lot of people started to ask this question: is it safe to get vaccinated during the periods, especially the first day?
So again, it's some rumor going on around in the social media also that the immunity of the body is weak during the times of menstruation and the vaccine should be avoided. So it is completely a myth and a misconception. The immunity of the body is as strong during the menstrual days as it is earlier or later, and one can safely take the vaccination on any day of the menstrual period. It's absolutely safe.
Okay. Thank you so much. That's going to quell this myth once and for all of us. The next question, ma'am, one of the viewers asked. So, you know, we had put this question that, you know, whether people want to ask any of, we have this collection of questions. So one of the questions is that she said that I was supposed to get my periods on 5th of May, but I was COVID positive and never got them. I also have PCOD, she says. Is there a relation between COVID and delayed menstrual cycle?
Okay, so there's no relation between COVID and delayed menstrual cycles, as this particular lady who said she could have missed her periods because of PCOD also. But in general, the menstrual period, menstrual cycle can be disturbed by any illness, you know, because of the physical effects of the illness, because of the fever, because of the mental stress that comes with the illness, or because of the disturbance in the sleep pattern or a disturbance in the dietary pattern. Any kind of illness can influence your menstrual cycle. So can the COVID. So otherwise, COVID particularly is not associated with any kind of delay in the periods or any affection of the menstrual cycles.
Okay. Great, ma'am. Thank you so much for answering this viewer's question. And, you know, we right now come to the end of this conversation that we are having, where you, you know, really put a lot of light to issues of gynecology and COVID. So, ma'am, you know, one question that I want to ask you, you know, this is like a question of hope, is that if there is one thing that you would love to see happening, what it would be?
Okay, so one thing I would love to see happening is all of us fighting against this pandemic with a lot of positivity. And I would also love to see the pandemic going away and everything returning to a normalcy, but also side by side retaining the good things that we have learned from the COVID infection. Maybe it's about the decreasing pollution levels, the decreasing traffic levels, or a lot more greenery around us, or maybe the newly discovered bonding that we have developed with our family members. So certain positive things we should always retain. Whatever new learnings we have got, we must retain them with us forever. And I really hope this pandemic goes away soon, and I really pray for the, you know, safety of all our countrymen and all over the world, the human race all over the world, and I hope we all fight it together as a common humanity.
Great vision, ma'am. Great vision. Ma'am, like one bonus question I want to ask. you know, regarding our current healthcare infrastructure, especially with respect to gynecology and with respect to mother and child welfare and care. Is there some lesson that we have learned, or is there something required to augment the infrastructure, healthcare infrastructure, and the total scenario of mother and child welfare in India, especially after COVID?
There are a lot of things that need to be done. We, before the COVID pandemic came, everyone knows we are already, you know, understaffed in terms of manpower. The ratio of, you know, per person to a person to doctor ratio, a person to staff ratio. So everything is very low as compared to other countries. So we were really understaffed in terms of manpower, in terms of health infrastructure, in terms of the health facilities that we have at the root levels in villages and, you know. So we really need to, you know, make sure that, you know, we need to boost it up now more, like in terms of fighting with such kind of calamities that occur so suddenly and we are left, you know, in a state of disarray. So we all really collectively need to think over this, that in terms of health infrastructure, we need to be far, far ahead if we want to prevent such kind of casualties coming across. So we all need to learn our own lessons in this.
So ma'am, you know, thank you for, you know, answering my bonus question, and thank you a lot for answering all the questions. Some of the questions would really help a lot of people who are watching this, you know, because there are lots of, because, you know, this is a time of WhatsApp forwards, and to get verified, qualified technical information from real doctors is a big deal for a lot of people. You know, they will actually get to understand what is the actual truth, what are the facts, and what is a professional advice. So ma'am, you know, and one more thing is, like, I want to really thank you, because, you know, you had opened up this new initiative that any gynecology patient who is also COVID positive can reach you out for any emergency. So with your permission, I would also share that link in the description of this video, you know, so that if anybody wants to reach out to you, they can reach out to you. And also, ma'am, all of us are right comfortable in our homes, and you as a doctor are going to the hospital and taking care of all of us. So on the behalf of everybody, all the viewers and all the citizens, I really want to thank you collectively and personally and individually, that thank you so much for, you know, taking all this risk, because a lot of healthcare workers have lost their lives, have, you know, gone into severe infections, but you have, as a doctor, committed to helping patients. So thank you so much, and thank you so much for giving time today.
Thank you, Raja. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to interact with the viewers today. And I would again like to reiterate here that any lady who is COVID positive, or is now, she is COVID positive and suffering any kind of gynecological problem, can reach out to me through a text. I hope you will share the number. And thank you for spreading that message also. And that is my own little way of, you know, extending out any help that much that I can do. And through your video, I know we are still doing little work that we can do, but I really salute the frontline workers, the doctors who are treating the COVID positive patients, you know, the serious patients, the patients who have developed complications, and they are day and night treating these kind of patients and seeing them struggling, seeing that they are bringing them out of the disease and out of the severe infections. So I think they are the people who are really doing a great work, and I, through the video today, I would really extend a thanks to them also. Thank you for being there.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. It was great having you. Thank you.